House Speaker Nancy Pelosi was one of several high-profile women to address the country last night at the Democratic National Convention, sharing her support for the Biden-Harris ticket. And Speaker Pelosi joins us now from San Francisco. Madam Speaker, thank you for being with us. Again, we heard you say last night, you've seen, and I'm quoting, firsthand, President Trump's disrespect for facts, for working families, and for women in particular. What were you referring to?
I was referring to his policies that we know are anti-women and his conduct. But let's just talk about the policies, if we will. I went on to say that we know what he probably doesn't is that when women succeed, America succeeds. And so we want to protect a woman's right to choose and preserve Roe v. Wade. We want to have a guarantee of affordable, quality child care and able to unleash the full power of women. We want to also have strength in Social Security and equal pay for equal work. And who's standing in the way? Mitch McConnell and Donald Trump, to name a few of our women-oriented priorities to unleash the power of women.
You have been, you're in San Francisco, but you've attended many conventions, as a lot of us have. This one's different by necessity. But do you think that we are looking at the way conventions are going to be going forward?
This is my 15th convention. My first when I was 12 years old, going with my father, Mayor of Baltimore, our whole family, Italian Americans. We take the whole family to the convention wherever we go. And that was interesting. But but I do think it was beautifully, magnificently handled. And I do, as a chair of a convention in San Francisco in 1984, as chair of the host committee of the convention, I've played every role. I've been chair in one convention of the platform committee. I've been chair of the delegate selection committee. I've been chair of the convention, the whole convention. And I can have an appreciation for what they did to pull this off, and it was magnificent. I had the privilege of thanking the staff earlier today. I think our future is probably a hybrid, because this was great. It had impact, it had succinctness, it had clarity, but it didn't have our collaboration of seeing each other, which I still think is something very important to the strength of the party. But if I had to choose one way, actual or virtual, I would choose virtual. But I think hybrid is the wave of the future, where we can have the benefit of both, the impact as well as the collaboration.
That's very interesting. You are convening the House of Representatives. You've got some travel ahead of you. That's this Saturday. And you're going to be trying to pass a bill that will forbid the Postal Service from cutting back on services that would impede voting by mail. My question is, do you expect to get Republican support for this? And while you say Republicans are losing on this issue and you say they're scared, how confident are you that once this bill passes, the president's gonna abide by it?
Well, all we can do is put it on his desk. I do think we will have some Republican support from what they have been saying. We'll see how they vote. But this is something that hits home for America's families. The post office the Postal Service is over 90% positive rating from the American people, higher than any agency of government. It is as American as our Constitution, that is as written in the Constitution, that we will have a postal service and that Congress shall minister to establishing the roads, et cetera, the postal roads, et cetera. And so it's as American as our Constitution, apple pie, motherhood, baseball, the Postal Service. And right now we have a situation where members across the country, Democrats and Republicans, are getting reports of delayed mail that affects prescriptions that our veterans expect. Nearly 100% of veteran VA prescriptions go through the mail. Last year, 1.2 billion prescriptions went through the mail. That was in 2019, well before the coronavirus hit. So in this time of a pandemic, compounded by the time of an election where people want to vote by mail so they don't have to risk their health in order to vote, for the post office to be pulling in post office the boxes and taking down the sorting machines and not increasing the overtime hours and the rest,
But
we'll have a bill to correct all of that.
And so how, at this point, how confident are you that the American people are going to fully have the ability to vote and have their votes counted in November?
Well, let me just say, we would never count on the Republicans for that because they sadly have put up obstacles to participation. But I know, as a former chair of the California Democratic Party, that Republicans very successfully vote by mail. They do. They led the way on this. And so across the country, Democrats and Republicans are supporting our call for more funding for vote by mail, as well as more funding for those who don't want to vote by mail to be able to safely vote by having more places, more distancing, more hours, more days where people can go to the polls and vote. Republicans are against that. But again, we don't agonize, we organize, and we're going to make sure that everyone has a plan well in advance to vote early, to ensure that their vote is counted as cast. The Postal Service wants to stand in the way of that. We'll make sure that we can overcome it.
Let me ask you about COVID relief before the Congress. You've been struggling to strike a deal, as we know, with Republicans on this. But this week, more than 100 Democrats in the House signed a letter urging you to pass a smaller relief bill than what you have out there. You were, had agreed to go from $3 trillion down to $2 trillion. But they would, they want to expand unemployment benefits, but basically they're saying after the duration of this COVID emergency that they would scale the support based on what the situation is in every state. But my question is, where do you stand on what they're asking you to do?
Well, they're asking us to do, and it's and I fully, from a policy standpoint, have always supported the stabilization. That means that if you say when unemployment reaches a certain point, that you would automatically have unemployment benefits. That's a very positive initiative. I've encouraged that. I have welcomed that suggestion. I don't think strategically it's where we should go right now because the Republicans would like to pass something like that and say, forget about it. Forget about state and local. Forget about our investments in stopping the virus. Forget about other initiatives about feeding the food insecure children in our country, vote by mail initiatives, and the rest. So I think that's something we should pass. I don't think the timing is for us to do it right now, because imagine that Republicans could take that into the Senate, put poison pills all over it. And it's hard to vote against extending unemployment benefits. And again, I think overwhelmingly our members who would not want to expand unemployment benefits. As I say, it's something I fully support and the stabilization, but not necessarily in the negotiation.
But just to clarify, then there you don't really see an opening here to get this thing resolved in the coming few days.
No, I do. And I don't think it's done by giving them an out. I think it's done by making them come into the negotiation. Because really the most central point of it all, where people's needs are met the most, is the issue of state and local government. And they have said, we don't think one state should pay for another state's concerns. Well, we in California have been paying for other people's concerns for a long time. So people in New York and the rest, that's the American way. We do it with great pride, not with any resentment. But they have said, oh, it's a tax issue. Why should people in one state help other people in another state? Welcome to the United States of America. I appreciate what my members are doing. I support fully that. But I don't necessarily think the timing of it is right now. I think that's something that we do when we know we will get it signed without poison pills.
Two other very quick things. The Russians being accused of interfering again in this year's presidential election. Senate Intelligence Committee report, you're very familiar with it. They say, among other things, the Russians are continuing to spread disinformation. Democrats are saying they're specifically planting disinformation with Republicans like Senator Ron Johnson. Do Democrats have the information, the evidence to back that up?
Yes, we have been briefed, but not to go into confirmatory denying anything. What we're saying is that the intelligence community should be putting forth what it can without jeopardizing sources and methods, of course. But there is no question that the Russians are 24/7 trying to undermine the integrity of our elections. The intelligence community knows that. In fact, they have stated that. But we have further evidence that they could state more fully, so that whether wittingly or unwittingly, those who might use that information have the fullest knowledge, and that the public knows what the Russians are up to. This is about our. I think the American people are clear. They would rather that they decide who the president of the United States is than Vladimir Putin, with his infiltration of our social media, with their supply, putting forth false information. I can't really go into so much of it. But it's very wrong. The administration knows it's wrong. And the president does anything but invite it. And then they try to make it, what is problematic is they try to make some equivalents. Well, this country's doing that and this country's doing that. There is nothing like what the Russians are doing. We don't want anybody interfering in our elections. But that, just don't make it look like it's on a par with other things. Yeah. It is a major assault on our democracy, and it has a bigger agenda. It has the agenda of undermining democracies, and they've done it in our country, and they've done it in other countries throughout the world. We should not allow our country to be allow this to happen and be accomplices to their undermining of democracy.
The Speaker of the House of Representatives, Nancy Pelosi, thank you very much for joining us.
My pleasure. Thank you.